Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning on the second Sunday of Advent and the first Sunday of December. As we step into the Advent season of worship, it's a season of celebration and a season of anticipation. We celebrate the one who has come. We anticipate his coming again. And a warm welcome to all of you for joining us this morning as we gather for worship on this wonderful day. Each Sunday in Advent, we also light a candle. And this has long been a tradition in the Christian church. It's a way of marking the growing of light, the light of Christ and his first coming, and the growing light of the longing for his return. And leading us in our liturgy this morning is Heather Tuin. I'll invite her forward at this time for the lighting of the Advent candle.
On this second Sunday of Advent, we light the candle of peace. Please join us in this responsive reading of our Advent liturgy. The scriptures record how even in the Garden of Eden, God had a plan to redeem his fallen people through the coming of Jesus Christ.
A voice of one calling
in the desert, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the wilderness a highway for our God. As we come closer to Christmas, our days are filled with preparations. Let us also prepare our hearts to celebrate again the coming of our Savior.
Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come and has redeemed his people.
We light this second Advent candle as we prepare to mark the coming of the one who would save his people from their sins. Join me in prayer to the one who has come and is coming again. Heavenly Father, how great and awesome you are. From the moment we first failed, you set in motion your plan to gather us back into fellowship with you. Even now, our Lord Jesus is preparing for his return. May we be ready not only for this festive season, but also to meet our Lord and Savior when he comes. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Please join us as we stand to worship and sing, O Come, Emmanuel.
Thank you.
the one who has come, and the one who will come again greets us this morning with these words. Grace to you and peace from God who is our Father in Christ the Son and the power and the presence of the Spirit. Together, God's people say, Amen. For centuries, the Christian church has professed together what it is we believe when it comes to the gospel. And that gospel is summarized in the words of the Apostles' Creed, the Christian faith. Catechism tells us of this. It is a creed beyond doubt and confessed throughout the world. Join me in professing our faith together this morning using the words of the Apostles' Creed. Together we say, I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. People of God, this is our faith, and let's rejoice and sing about it as well as we sing Wonderful, Merciful Savior.
Thank you.
The promise of Scripture is that every heart that seeks Him will find Him when they seek Him with all his heart. And we do so again this morning in a time of prayer. And a couple of prayer updates to give. We're going to continue to pray for Sharon Van Kalker. She's been moved to the Laurels in Galesburg for physical therapy, recovering from a bout with pneumonia. And want to lift her up in prayer. Grateful to see Jerry Oley back with us this morning. We've been praying for him. He's been dealing with some health issues. And he says he feels like $1 million. Now, if that were Canadian, it'd be like a dollar. But we're glad you're feeling great, Jerry. Really, really we are. And then just an update. You've been praying, and I thank you for your prayers for my family out west in the Pacific Northwest. They've been dealing with some significant flooding issues. They had another major rain system come through this week, caused some alarm. But thankfully, no further damage, and there's still a lot to recover from for everybody in the area. But thank you for your prayers. And we'll continue to pray for them. Let's go to God in prayer this morning. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you are an outrageously generous God. As we come to you in worship this morning, may we do so in awe of the gift of your Son, Jesus, whom you sent to save us from our sin. We marvel at such a gift. Truly, Advent is the story of your immeasurable goodness and amazing grace for us in your Son, Jesus. Father, the promise of Emmanuel is precious to those who know him. You have proven yourself to be a God who is not only with us in Jesus, but a God who is for us. And we thank you, Jesus, for everything you've already accomplished for us through your birth, your life, your death and resurrection, and for everything you're doing as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and for the sure and certain promise that we cling to again this morning that someday, one day soon, Maranatha, come Lord Jesus, you will return, and you will make all things new again. God, we need that renewing work. We pray that through the gospel you would help rearrange the price tags in our life. May the gospel of your forgiveness through Jesus Christ slow us and settle us and center us, that by faith we might declare with Paul that I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ. Father, we pray this morning for those who do not know you, do not walk by faith or think they walk by faith but are not quite sure, and we ask that you would make the gospel beautiful here in our worship this morning, and for all of us, continue to remind us that your gospel is irresistible. And for those who do know you, O God, take us to even greater intimacy with yourself. Renew us for those days when our faith feels thin and our faith feels weak. When events of this world disturb us and cause us to wonder, how long, O Lord, how long will this continue? But guide us into the riches of your grace. And guide us into the paths of peace. We know, O God, that we live in a world between the two advents of Jesus. But in the meantime, may we love mercy, may we do justice, and may we walk humbly with you. Lord, we lift up the needs of many. We pray for those within this community of faith. We pray for those in our larger community. May your presence be near to them. God, we pray for those who are receiving medical treatment for some concerns. We pray for those who are recovering from recent health concerns. God, we pray for those who long for peace in their hearts and long for peace in their homes. Be with those who daily struggle with depression or mental illness that makes peace seem so distant. Lord, we pray for those who suffer from addictions. May the promise, O God, of your love for them recalibrate the true longing of their hearts. God, this past week in this state, we saw again tragedy happen. Students gunned down in classrooms in Oxford. God, we need your peace. And we thank you that in the midst of all this tragedy and hardship and longing for something more, you promise us your peace because you've given us the Prince of Peace. May the light of his glory and the guarantee of what is and what is to come move us, O God, to be able and willing from now on to walk with him. And with joy, let earth receive its King. And let every heart prepare him room and heaven and nature sing. We pray this all in the name of Jesus, the one who was and who is to come. Amen. A couple of announcements this morning. Your Heritage Happenings, and you can pick up a copy of this at the Information Center if you would like us to email you this on Thursday mornings. Just send an email into our church office and we'll make sure that you get that. There's a Christmas concert coming this coming Tuesday. It's being hosted at Centerpoint Church, December 7 at 7:30 p.m. The Singing Crusaders and others are joining for a wonderful evening of worship and invite you to come and be a part of that. Just a reminder, next Sunday is our annual congregational meeting in which we talk about ministry, what God has been doing here, and thinking about what we long and see for God to do in the coming year. So join us following the worship service next Sunday as we meet to talk about this mission and ministry here at Heritage Church. And then there's a reminder to you as well. This coming week, we'll be sending out our list of our homebound members. Every year we love to send and just blanket them with Christmas cards. And we're going to send them Christmas cards and cookies, and that list will come out probably on Wednesday. And we invite you to just bring all of that here to the church. And then later on this month, our deacons or some of our ministry team will make sure that our homebound members receive this just wonderful outpouring of love through Christmas cards. Then a couple quick announcements here as well. We have a special offering that's planned for this month in December that is for the Kalamazoo Gospel Ministries. They're hoping to open their Women's and Children's Center. We sent a list out a few weeks ago. We can send that again if you would like, or talk to somebody at the table, I believe, outside the office. They're looking for supplies, right? Bedding and all of these sort of things. And you can drop those all off in our lobby. There's boxes set up for that. That's going to be our Christmas blessing for the Kalamazoo Gospel Ministries here in our community. Just a reminder, we have a Christmas Eve service planned. Typically, we meet on Christmas Day, but Christmas Day is on a Saturday this year, so we thought we'd do a Christmas Eve service on Friday, December 24. Join us as for carols and candles and the Christmas story. It's a wonderful celebration that we'll have here together on that Christmas Eve. Our offering this morning is a ministry support for this congregation. Our Kingdom Initiative is for hospice care of Southwest Michigan. Many of us have had contact with that organization. It's an end-of-life ministry and care, and we're grateful to support them, and that will be received. All the offerings will be received at the doors on your way out of the sanctuary this morning. So that'll happen at the conclusion of our service. Well, at this time, I invite you to open God's Word with me as we're going to look this morning at the prophet Isaiah once again. We're in a series here at Heritage titled The Weary World Rejoices, this morning looking at Isaiah 40. You'll find that on page 754. So already in our service this morning, just by way of intro, we've talked about the reality that we live between the two advents of Jesus. And it's not odd for us in this season to look at the manger, to remember that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we've seen his glory. So a lot of our attention will be focused on the manger. And it gets caught up in a lot of sentimentality, I think, in our culture. But as followers of Jesus Christ, we believe that Christ's incarnation was necessary and not just a side note on the redemptive story. Through his life and his death and his resurrection and his ascension and the promise that he is coming back, we know that sin's curse loses its grip on those who belong to Christ. We celebrate that every Advent. But we don't just look at a manger, and the prophet Isaiah helps us in this. We don't just look at a manger. Advent is also a season in which we fix our eyes on the end of the story. We look beyond the manger and beyond the present and we look to the future. And the book of Revelation tells us we are looking for the day in which God says, I will wipe all the tears from your eyes. Isn't that an astounding promise? He will wipe every tear from our eyes. The question is, what do we do with our tears between now and that day? And as we open God's word this morning in Isaiah 40, he's going to help us answer that question. What do we do with our tears between now and the day when Christ returns? Our passage is Isaiah 40, verses 1 through 11. Let's ask for the Spirit's blessing, and then we'll read God's word together. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, you are God of great comfort. And now as we open your word here in this place, as by your Spirit I desire and long to proclaim this word of peace again this morning, be present in this place in our hearts. Give us ears to hear that which is true, that which will stand forever. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Invite you to stand for the reading of God's word this morning, Isaiah 40, verses 1 through 11. Isaiah 40, 1 through 11. Listen to God's word. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her hard service has been completed, that her sin has been paid for, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice of one calling in the desert, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the wilderness a pathway, a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up, every mountain and hill made low. The rough ground shall become level, the rugged places a plain. And the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all mankind together will see it. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry out. And I said, what shall I cry? All men are like grass, and all their glory is like the flowers of the field. The grass withers and the flowers fall, because the breath of the Lord blows on them. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flowers fail, but the word of our God stands forever. You who bring good tidings to Zion, go up on a high mountain. You who bring good tidings to Jerusalem, lift up your voice with a shout. Lift it up. Do not be afraid. Say to the towns of Judah, here is your God. See, the sovereign Lord comes with power, and his arm rules for him. See, his reward is with him, and his recompense accompanies him. He tends his flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in his arms and carries them close to his heart. He gently leads those that have young. This is God's word for us. This morning, you may be seated once again. Comfort, comfort. In the old Handel's Messiah version, ye my people, says your God. If you were to glance and have read the entire book of Isaiah, that was not the expectation this morning, but if you happen to have read it prior to this morning, you'll notice that there's a significant shift that happens with Isaiah 40, verse 1. This is sort of that 3,000-foot view of our passage this morning. From chapter 1, verse 1 through chapter 39 in the last verse, it's been a lot about judgment. It's been a lot about God's condemnation of his people. The kings had failed. The people had abandoned their God. So much word from God through the prophet Isaiah, it would seem that there was little hope, little chance of peace for God's holy and dearly loved people. And then we come to our verse this morning, comfort, comfort ye. Around the time that Isaiah is ministering in the history of God's people, it's important to see this, not only the shift in context or shift in tone of the prophet, but here's the historical perspective. Around the time in which Isaiah is ministering, called by God to prophesy, the northern kingdom, which is Israel, the 10 tribes of Israel, by now they have been taken away into captivity. So it's sometime after 722 before Christ. They've been brought away by the Assyrian Empire. The southern kingdom, which is the kingdom in which Isaiah is ministering, the kingdom that we're focused on this morning, kingdom of Judah. There's two tribes that comprise this. Their day was coming. It was likely about 100 years away in which Isaiah spoke these words of comfort. King Hezekiah was on the throne. He actually was a pretty good king. Most of the kings actually of Judah were actually pretty good kings. And Isaiah, at the end of chapter 39, it's just given a grim picture to Hezekiah saying, man, all this trouble is about to come. A time of captivity that Isaiah prophesied, and that captivity would last for about 70 years. And sadly, Hezekiah says, well, this is my paraphrase, by the way. Well, at least it's not in my time. So much had been lost. So much was going to be lost. And now as you hear that context, it's hard, or it isn't hard really, it isn't hard to imagine if you were one of the remnant, the faithful of God's people, you've just heard from the prophet Isaiah, and you're hearing what's about to come, and there are tears streaming down your face. There would be so many years to endure. And yet, long before it happens, we get back to Isaiah 40, verse 1. Long before it happens, God sends a word through Isaiah, words of peace, words of comfort. Now, comfort here is not like a lazy boy chair. I've got one of those at home. I love it. So comfortable. So comfortable. Or like a blanket you wrap around yourself on a cold morning. It's not, you've probably heard this before, right? That's not the comfort that Isaiah has in mind here. The literal translation is come forth, or with strength. How do we go into tomorrow, into next week, into next year, Lord willing? How do we do it? With strength. That's what Isaiah is preaching, prophesying to God's people. How would this comfort, the sense of finding strength in what will be a season of tears and a season of sorrow? That's what Isaiah said then, and it's just as applicable to us today. How do we face tomorrow, next week, next year, 10 years, Lord willing? How do we do that with the tears that are streaming from our face? Comfort, comfort, my people, says your God. Those are beautiful words. Again, you're imagining here that you're of the remnant. You're not of those who've rejected God. You're not those who've turned your back on God. You're the remnant. You're the faithful. And you hear again from the prophet, this is words of promise. My people, your God. Precious words of covenant-filled promise. In other words, it's not over for us yet. This reminder that God has to constantly do throughout history, and he does this in order to bring his people back. Because we get restless, we wander, right? God says again, hey, I've not forgotten my promise. I will not abandon you. I am still your God. You are still my people. But a lot's going to happen to them that's going to test their faith in that promise. Judah, remember the kingdoms? Israel, Judah, Israel. Judah had seen Israel swept away by the Syrians in 722. And you know they could see, their people could get in, and they could see the utter destruction of their neighbors to the north. And so they're wondering, we've just heard this call of judgment. We have time. We don't know when it's going to come. We know by history it's going to, what, maybe 100 years later. It's a long time, easy to forget, in 100 years. I forgot what I had for breakfast this morning. Right? 100 years later, and yet God, Isaiah 40 verse 1, God whispers, he whispers to his people, comfort. Comfort my people. says your God. The day is going to come when they're going to feel crushed, perplexed, hard-pressed. And here in Isaiah 40, what we're going to pick up out of this passage for us today, and read it, of course, through the lens of hearing what God's people then were thinking and feeling, but we're going to hear this morning three God-shaped reasons, and we need this because this past week here in Michigan, we know what's happened just north of Detroit with another shooting in a school, and that's just one of 100,000 different things that make us think, man, this world is in trouble. And here we're going to find in Isaiah 43 gospel-shaped, peace-filled realities that tell us why we can have peace today. Let's look at them. Here's the first one. We can know peace because of God's promise to restore. Beautiful picture, right? The valleys are going to be filled. I mean, just use your imagination this morning. Don't click on the YouTube version of your mind. It's all graphics, right? Just use your imagination. The valleys. Think of the Grand Canyon. Filled. Every mountain. I grew up on the West Coast. I saw some pretty big ones. Every mountain made low. Roads over rough places, just smooth. I mean, imagine it as a scene in which literally, and it's got to be careful to use that word, but quite literally, every barrier between where we are now and where we will be someday, because we long for Christ and His return. Imagine every stumbling block, every tragedy, every struggle, every trial, all of it. Right? Because this is imagery. All of it. Gone. How can we have peace, comfort, when there is so much not right in our world today? And there isn't. But as we wait, and that's prophet, right? As we wait, we shed our tears, don't we? The tears of a married couple, for example, who never dreams that they'd be unable to conceive a child. The tears of a student who studies so hard, and the kid next to him cheats and gets a better grade. That's hard. The tears of a broken-hearted community that we see this past week, and a broken-hearted nation again, where several students were killed in a shooting. There are tears. How do we have peace? Well, this is Isaiah now saying, fix your eyes. Fix your eyes on the day when God promises, Revelation 21, there's going to be no more tears because the mountains are going to be flat, the valleys are going to be filled, the rough ways are going to be made smooth. I mean, it's just, you've ever watched these shows, right, these home renovation shows? Right? This is God's renovation project for you, for every cancer diagnosis and Alzheimer's reality, for every physical limitation and every hardship of our hearts. God says, I'm going to renovate it all. I promise you. And this is where God speaks to a day when no human eye will have a tear in it evermore. We know by faith that that's the day in which Jesus is going to finish the good work that He began in us, Philippians 1, verse 6. And faith embraces that, right? Faith embraces not only the cradle of Christ, which is the first part of Advent, but we also embrace the cross and His crown and His coming again. That's the lens by which those who have faith in Jesus Christ, this is the lens by which we view the world. In which time will come and God's going to reverse all that is not right. I have peace today. We have peace in the midst of the storm because of God's one day promise to renovate everything. We also have peace, as Prophet Isaiah goes on to write in this passage. Remember, people, they know that trouble's coming. We also have peace because our hope rests, Our hope ultimately rests in the one who says, my word is never going to fail you. Like that promise with a stamp of approval on it. Here's the problem Isaiah raises in this passage, and I often hear this verse read, I've heard it in a way, right before a sermon, a pastor will say, right, the grass withers and fails, the word of the Lord stands, and that's a fitting moment. And yet in the context, what Isaiah is saying is incredibly unflattering for you and for me. He's basically saying here, you know what the problem with you is and me? Your glory doesn't last. You're temporary. Everything about us is temporary, and honestly, it's very frustrating. Recently, I think it was this past week, Time magazine came out with their picks of the 100 most influential people in the world. It's a very eclectic group of 100, and in my opinion, a lot of imagination was used to designate these 100 people as the most influential. But here's the thing. A few years from now, you will not be able to list most of the names. Because that's what Isaiah is saying here. They're going to fade from significance. Why? Well, it's because of the biblical fact about all of us, and that is that our glory doesn't last. You could dress it up any way you want. Put lipstick on it, as they say, right? It's still a pig. But, remember, I'm Isaiah, me, this morning, we're trying to build up your peace. You can count on one thing, and that's God's promise in His Word, which we just touched on really a moment ago as well. The only thing, and this is hard because if you're a creator by maybe a mechanical engineering or computer engineering, stuff, you're a creator, a builder. It's tangible, right? You think, I'm going to build something that's going to last, and then Isaiah basically says it's not, but there is something that will. The only thing you can really count on is that what God has said will come true. His word is His guarantee. Where's the peace in all of that? Maybe it's enough for you this morning. I know from my own heart where I'm at today, it's enough just to hear it. Enough simply to hear that God says, my promise will stand because my word is forever. He says, I love you. I forgive you. Come be with me. Follow my son and you will find life. That promise never changes. We live in a world where there's so little that is certain, so little that feels enduring. And here's the promise of peace. I mean, the only thing that seems to always be around is our tears. And God speaks into the midst of that. He says, I want you to know my word, it stands. It is the constant. And that word tells us, not even your tears will be forever. Not even your tears. Comfort, comfort my people. A day is coming when wrongs will be righted, evil will be destroyed, truth will be prevail. Why do we have peace? Why does somebody who's not a believer, for example, look and say, what is with you? And I'll say, I've got peace, first of all, because God's promised this is not going to be forever. And second, His promise is true. His word never fails. Now let's look at the third one. How can I have peace today? And that is because of God's heart toward us. Beautiful imagery here in which God says, I am a shepherd. Isaiah is told, speak to the people, Judah, Jerusalem, tell them all, here is your God. Well, who is our God? Well, He's this shepherd. Listen again to verse 11. He tends His flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in His arms, carries them close to His heart. He gently leads those that have young. If you've been a follower of Jesus for any time, you've heard this before. Maybe you've never heard it before, but this is a defining truth for those who long for the day when there's going to be no more tears. Why do we have peace as we wait for the day of Christ's return? Why do we have peace? Because life's disappointments are real. Marriages are still breaking apart. cancer causes great pain and sorrow. Faith is wrestling with doubt. Injustice is out there. It's wreaking havoc. But, and this is where faith sings, would you rather face all of this with or without God? That's a serious question. I don't deny for a moment. There's a lot of trouble out there. I have my tears. But I would rather face them with God than without Him, which is exactly the message of the book of Job, by the way. Because in the end of it, God basically says to Job, where were you when I did all of this? And he said, basically, I'm still here. Would you rather face your tears with or without God? That's the promise of God being a shepherd. Sadly, many people opt to do this without God. But why do we, who are in Christ, have peace in the waiting with tears? It's because faith knows that God is the shepherd in the midst of it. And He gathers the lambs in His arms. Or as we profess in Lord's Day 1, He is our only comfort in life and in death. And I'll let you know today, December 5, this has special significance for my family. It was 16 years ago today that our daughter, Emily Grace, passed away. I talked about her this past summer. Happened to be the Sundays fell on significant moments in her life. August 21 was her birthday, 20 years ago. I shared then how as a result of some medical complications, she had a very, very challenging life. Very difficult one, not without joy. Hopefully today our family will pull out some of those old tapes, you know, the kinds that still have moving parts. And we'll watch some of those memories. We often knew in the midst of that, deep within us, there was this peace that just can't be explained. But on Monday, December 5, 2005, 16 years ago, Emily completed her earthly journey. And that moment is seared in our hearts. I still picture Heather sitting on the couch, holding Emily in her arms. It's just seared there, and there's still tears. But the same peace that filled us before that moment still carries us through this one. We had inscribed on Emily's gravestone these words: safe in the shepherd's arms. I'll tell you today, those words are just as true for her as they are for you. Safe in the shepherd's arms. These words are true for all who embrace Christ as the one who has come and the one who is coming again. The one born in a manger, crucified on a cross, risen from the grave, ascended to God's throne, and one day is coming back. You are safe. Safe in the shepherd's arms, and He will take your tears as He speaks words of comfort to you. We're safe because of God's promise, which Isaiah points out in this passage. We're safe because God's word can be trusted. We're safe because He carries us like a shepherd close to His heart. This is the message of Isaiah, prophesied thousands of years ago to a people who were about to face a life full of tears. And to the remnant, God says, comfort. Comfort my people, says your God. If you don't have that peace this morning, it can. It can be yours. It's a glorious thing of the gospel. By faith, all you have to do is receive the one who's coming again. If you know this peace, or maybe you just need to be like even me this morning as my family's all kind of caught up in what today means for us. I mean, it can feel a little restless too. And yet we know the peace. And because of that, we know that, that God has made a way for us to himself. That's what the manger represents and the cross declares. And all we have to do is embrace the peace amid the chaos. It's a peace that God secures in his Son, Jesus Christ. It's a peace that was bought at a price. This morning we're going to gather at the table. Here's a table in which it is filled with God's message of peace. And we're going to eat the bread and we're going to drink the cup which proclaims Christ's death until he comes again. And we're going to say, here is the peace of God that surpasses understanding. May that be yours today. Take hold of God's promise. The peace of his word which says it's going to stand forever. The peace of the good shepherd in whose arms we are kept safe. May that peace be yours. Precious as it is, because Christ is the Prince of Peace, and he comforts all who seek him and find him when they seek him with all their heart. Let's pray together. Precious Father, you are a God who gathers our tears. And when the sorrows like sea billows roll, yet there still is a peace like a river. We pray, O Father, as we look at our own hearts and lives, and even as we look at our church, and then we look at our world, and we can feel so distracted and burned by it, Lord, may your peace fill us. Maybe even deep abiding joy, which we're going to sing about in a moment. Rejoice, rejoice, believers. Do this work in us, Holy Spirit, because we need this renovation project which you have begun to continue in us until the day that you complete it, Lord Jesus, at your return. Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. We pray this in your name. Amen. Let's stand and worship as we sing together, Rejoice, Rejoice, Believers. People of God, what is our only comfort in life and in death? It's that we don't belong to ourselves, that we are not our own, but belong body and soul in life and in death to our faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. We profess these words in Heidelberg Catechism, Lord's Day 1, question and answer 1. What is your comfort today? As we gather here this morning at the table of our Lord, this is real comfort-filled hope that God feeds us with here through Christ. God is here, and His reward is with Him. And as we come to the table this morning, may we do so with our hearts lifted up to Christ, who has come and will come again. He is the one for whom we must be ready, for He is the one who brings grace, and life, and comfort to all who receive them as their Savior and King. As we celebrate this meal together this morning, the very one who's coming open for us the way of salvation, the one whose triumphant return we eagerly await, listen to the words spoken at the very first celebration of the Lord's Supper. The Lord Jesus, on the night He was betrayed, took bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, "This is My body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of Me." In the same way, after supper, He took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in My blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of Me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes again." People of God, we proclaim our faith this morning here at the table, signed and sealed in this sacrament. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. As Jesus said a prayer before sharing this meal with His disciples, please join me as we pray together. Lord our God, we pray You will send Your Holy Spirit so that this bread and cup may be for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Comfort us, for we need comforting. Prepare us, even as we make ourselves ready in this Advent season, that our hearts will be Your home. May we be united with Christ. May we remain faithful in hope and in love. And may the peace of Christ, which surpasses understanding, guard our hearts and minds. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying together, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be Your name. Your kingdom come, Your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For Yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Congregation of Jesus Christ, come to communion. Take hold of God's comfort and grace. For when you do, the greatest of comforts will be yours. Come, all who are truly sorry for their sin, who sincerely believe in Jesus Christ, and who desire to live in obedience to Him as Lord, come with gladness to the table of our Savior. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. And as this is being passed around this morning, we'll sing together of the Father's love begotten. Take, eat, remember, and believe that the body of our Lord Jesus Christ was given for the complete forgiveness of all our sins. The cup of thanksgiving, for which we give thanks, is a sharing in the blood of Christ. And as the cups are distributed, we'll sing together, "Lo, how a rose e'er blooming." Take, drink, remember, and believe the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ was shed for the complete forgiveness of all our sins. Please join me in prayer. You are holy, O God of majesty, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord and Savior. You sent him into this world to satisfy the longings of your people for a Savior, to bring freedom to the captives of sin, to establish justice for the oppressed. Jesus, you came among us as one of us. You took the lot of the poor. You shared in our suffering. We rejoice again today that in your death and rise again, you have set before us the sure promise of new life, the certain hope of a heavenly home where we will all sit at the table with Jesus, our host. Send us out, O God, in Jesus' name, filled with the Holy Spirit, people of peace, to touch an ordinary, everyday world with the promise of your peace that is found in Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. We stand for God's blessing. Having been nourished in God's grace this morning, hear also these words from Philippians 4, verses 6 through 7. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all human understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Jesus Christ. This is God's promise. It is the promise of all who put their trust in him. And as we do so again in the days to come, receive God's blessing as you leave this place. And now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, may he equip you with everything good for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Together, God's people say, Amen.